STEM fans, are you ready? Let's hear it for the world-class NASA STEM Stars team. From NASA centers across the country, we present Red Jensen.
Welcome, STEM fans. I am your host, Deb Baggett, and we have a special guest today, Red Jensen. Red, we are glad to have you with us today.
Hi, Deb. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Not a problem at all. This is our 58th episode of NASA STEM Stars and one of our special episodes in Advanced Air Mobility, or AAM. Red, who has many titles, sUAS Chief Pilot being one of them, is here to talk to us today about advanced air mobility. Can you give our STEM fans a brief summary on what is AAM and how it's related to what you do here at NASA?
Sure. AAM is a very broad subject, but from my perspective, dealing with unmanned aircraft, we have to really figure out how to safely operate them and integrate them around other people, other aircraft and buildings and obstacles and things like that. So we're developing software processes and procedures to allow these vehicles to operate, around other people and around other vehicles so that they're intelligent enough to fly themselves and see and avoid other obstacles.
So it sounds like the aircraft have their own little air traffic control system within themselves, and then they have to communicate with the other aircraft. Is that sort of what it is?
Yeah, that would be the ideal solution. Unfortunately, we're not quite there yet, so we're still working on that. We use a variety of different sensors. Some are vision-based, some are acoustic, some are radar. And we're trying to sort of fuse all these different technologies together to allow a system that's basically platform agnostic. In other words, it doesn't belong to a specific aircraft. It can go on any aircraft and let people start receiving packages by drone, things like that. But also for, transporting people around. Someday there's going to be pilotless aircraft that'll take the places of buses and taxis, for instance.
That sounds exciting, and I can't wait for that to actually be implemented. AAM is a very technical field and a little bit beyond my pay grade. So before we dive deeper into AAM, let's learn a little bit more about Red. Red, can you tell us about where you grew up and a little bit more about your education?
Sure. I grew up in a town in Northern California called Santa Rosa. It's about an hour north of San Francisco. And I lived there for the first 40 plus years of my life before I moved south here to work at NASA Armstrong. I'm an airplane nut. I like anything that flies and really by extension, anything with a motor in it. So, all kinds of motorsports and stuff like that. As far as education goes, I did it the absolute wrong way. I don't have a degree. I never spent a day in college. I'm completely self-taught. It's a difficult path to get to where I'm at. The way I did it, and I wouldn't recommend it to anyone, but I will say if you have the passion and the drive, you can absolutely do it.
So by self-taught, does that mean instead of going to college, you read the books and did your own learning, or was it more on-the-job training?
Yeah, it was definitely the former. Airplanes and aircraft and aeronautics in general ignited a passion in me from my very earliest memories that created sort of an insatiable appetite. I could never learn enough. I'm a voracious reader, always researching, always studying, always asking questions and trying to learn more just about doing things that I loved. I never meant it to be my vocation. It was always just a passion. And I, figured I would have a job so that I could afford to fly and not that I would be able to fly for a living. So that's been a dream come true, really.
So if you loved reading and loved studying, and this may be a personal question, but why didn't you go to college?
That is a great question. I was on track to go to college, and I took a summer off after, or took a year off after high school prior to going to school. And I took a job in an auto body shop just to, something to do, save a little money, try to pay my way, my own way through school. And it turned out that I was entered into an apprenticeship program for auto refinishing painting, basically. And I advanced relatively quickly in that and started making, you know, really good money in a short period of time, and just sort of delayed things. And you know, I just never went. So, you know, it was tough making a good paycheck. It was tough to, you know, think about curtailing that and, you know, dedicating 4 years to something else. So just a decision I made along the way.
No, I totally understand. Like you said, when you get that paycheck, it's hard to give up the paycheck to go back to school. And you know, starving students.
Absolutely. And I was doing flight training at the time. So it was paying for all of my, you know, aircraft rental and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, life was pretty good. So that's where I stayed.
Yeah. Well, and being somebody in your position now as an SUAS chief pilot, how you got there is not what somebody would expect. We'd expect the regular routine, you know, went to college. And so it sounded like a lot of your hobbies kind of drove you to the path. So tell us a little bit more about your hobbies and interests.
Yeah, without question, I have my hobbies to thank for where I'm at today. You know, building and flying radio controlled models is something that I did with my father from my very earliest memories. I'd always been, you know, drawn to that. And like I said before, the job was really just a way for me to pay for my fun stuff. And, you know, along the way, I found I had a knack for it and sort of progressed fairly rapidly through, you know, competitions and designing my own aircraft and helping other people out and things like that. So eventually I went to work for another company that made UAVs. And the picture on the right there is myself with one of the aircraft that we had built. And we had come to NASA Armstrong quite a bit to fly in the restricted airspace, because the things we were operating, you can't just kind of fly anywhere. They've got to be in the right kind of airspace. And got to know some of the folks there. And when the opportunity arose, they needed somebody to help out there. They offered me the job, and I eventually took it.
Well, it sounds like you are in the right path for your interests and your talents. We do have some questions coming in. So let me just take some questions real quick. Chris Elliott says, what kind of security controls do you implement when to make sure that your information is not compromised? Like if someone could change the mapping information, that would be a problem, right?
Yeah, that would be a problem. That's a great question. There are lots of measures in place to make sure that doesn't happen. One of the most common is our systems are what we call air gapped. So they're not connected to the internet. So you would have to take over control via RF signal or something like that. All of our radio links are encrypted, and it's a two-way handshake. So it's not like you can just sort of listen in and take control or something like that. So you have to have a digital encryption key to be able to talk to the aircraft or talk to the ground station. So it's very, very difficult for anybody to gain access to something like that.
We have another question from Miguel Flores. What's one of the biggest unmanned aircraft you've ever built in your career with an AI intelligence?
So, you know, most of the aircraft that we operate at Armstrong stop at about 330 pounds. That's where our charter stops. But we actually do operate aircraft on a wavered basis up to around 550 pounds. And that's called X-56. You can look that up if you like. And it's a twin turbine powered flying wing studying advanced control concepts, basically aeroelasticity, flutter suppression, things like that.
Excellent. All right, well, let's move on and we'll get to some more questions as we go throughout our episode. So we talked about your hobbies. Now, was there something that you were building that you wanted to mention? You were building a plane.
Yeah, so I'm, again, you know, an airplane junkie. But I've been going to the Reno National Championship Air Races in Reno, Nevada for, you know, nearly 40 years. My first was in 1979. And my dream is to compete there in the Formula One class. So I'm currently designing and building my own Formula One airplane to hopefully make it there and race someday. It's a massive project, especially for one person. So it's taken a long time, but you know, we're getting there and we'll see if I can make it happen.
So I've never built anything like that in my life. So when
Me
you're
either.
Talking about building a building a plane to race. You're not talking about a model plane. You are talking about a plane you are going to sit in and fly.
That's right. This is a full-scale airplane. You know, I'm not doing it the easy way. There are several plans out there that you can buy or even some kits, and I'm not doing that. I'm designing it completely from scratch on my own. It's about a 25-foot wingspan. It'll weigh around 500 pounds, and it's capable of about 250 to 300 miles an hour when it's all done.
That is incredible. I can't even imagine. I'm sure that your hobbies alone have not gotten you into your position at NASA. So what is the path that did get you into your position here?
Well, it was really kind of a short path in that I only worked at one other UAV company prior to this one. And I owned a hobby shop at the time, and this company's chief designer, we were friends, and he came in one day and said, "Hey, we're looking for somebody to pilot our aircraft. We've got a fairly important demonstration coming up, and, you know, are you interested?" And so I said, "Sure." So I did that kind of on a contract basis for a year or so, and then made the leap full time, and I ended up being there about 10 years. And during that time, I went from, you know, just a simple pilot to helping design all of the and integrate all the systems on board, and really taking what was just an airframe all the way to being a complete system that we could sell to our own military and other militaries around the world.
You must have some incredible skills. So that is quite amazing. And I have said your title a few times, which is sUAS Chief Pilot. What exactly does an sUAS Chief Pilot do?
So sUAS stands for Small Unmanned Aerial Systems, and basically I'm responsible for the airworthiness and operation of the center's fleet of unmanned aircraft. So we operate a fleet of maybe 25 or so different vehicles, everything up to the size of Global Hawk. So I don't operate Global Hawk, but everything else I have a hand in. I'm also responsible for pilot training and currency and qualification for all of the NASA Armstrong pilots as well as JPL. So we oversee a pilot training program and currency program to make sure everybody's qualified to operate the vehicles and can support the missions as necessary.
Okay, so you said there were different types and different sizes of the UAS. Could you explain that a little bit more?
Sure. So we deal with mainly Category 1 and Category 2. So Category 1 is up to 55 pounds. Category 2 is up to 330 pounds. And then we also have a couple of Cat 3s, X-56 being one of them. It's 550 pounds, and then, you know, goes on up from there. We operate both fixed-wing and rotary-wing vehicles, and we also operate unpowered gliders. So there are certain pilot ratings and training qualifications for each one of those to be able to operate the different weight classes and the different types of vehicles. So it's a fairly complex matrix to keep track of everybody's qualifications. But, you know, that's what we're supposed to do, and that's what we do.
Okay, and I do believe that you have brought a video showing one of your one of the models that you.
It's a fixed wing unpowered glider, and we're researching why birds don't have vertical tails. You know, for hundreds of thousands of years, humans have looked to the sky and seen birds fly, and then we start inventing airplanes, and the first thing we do is put a vertical tail on it, right? No bird has a vertical tail. And we're sort of researching why that is, and there's a paper out on that if you're interested in reading it. But it turns out birds carry the load differently on their wings than most airplanes do, and that's why they don't need a vertical tail. But I believe the video we're going to show is about the third flight of a 25-foot span unpowered glider. You can see that it's bungee launched, so it's getting towed aloft by a rubber band. And when the camera zooms in here, you can see the little parachute on the bottom of the aircraft. It'll drop away. It gets to about 150 feet in altitude. There, the parachute's dropping away. And now the vehicle is in free flight, and it's instrumented in such a way that we can tell airspeed, altitude, control rates, GPS position, things like that. So this is very early on in the test program. We're basically just exploring the flight envelope, making sure the aircraft is airworthy and safe to fly. You can see there's a GoPro camera on top. This aircraft flew very well right off the bat, so we felt comfortable putting a GoPro on it. Like I say, I believe this is the third flight ever on this vehicle. It's out on Rogers Dry Lake Bed, which is one of our UAS flight areas at NASA Armstrong. And it's about a 7 mile wide by 14 mile long lake bed. One of the best natural runways on the planet. And we're very fortunate enough to have a few square miles of UAS workspace out there. So this is primarily where we do all of our flying, especially of our bigger aircraft and some of our heavier and faster aircraft as well. The aircraft just basically climbs up and then glides down. This particular day, there wasn't much convective activity in the air, which is good for data collection. It makes it nice and stable, but it also means that you don't get to fly very long. Sometimes you can catch a thermal, which is a rising air current, and stay aloft for dozens of minutes or even hours, depending on what you're trying to do.
Now, that particular craft, I know that it didn't create its own power, but were you able to steer it? Or, I mean, it landed nicely, so I'm assuming that you had some hand in steering.
Yeah, absolutely. It has two-axis control, so it has a pitch control and a roll control. And it has combined control surfaces on the trailing edge of the wing. So they go up and down for pitch, and then they go left and right for roll control. And it's fully controllable.
Well, she flew so smoothly. I do have some questions coming in. Let me interrupt and ask these very quickly. So one person asks what is the future of AI and UAS?
So they're inextricably entwined. And, AI is sort of a broad term. I don't know that I would necessarily call everything that a manned aircraft does AI, or there's going to be any one AI program that runs everything. But, these vehicles need to learn to not necessarily think for themselves, but at least make decisions on their own based upon the input that they're getting. So ultimately, they have to see and avoid, whether that's people, other aircraft, buildings, whatever. They're going to have to know that these obstacles are there, and they're going to have to react to it. Right now, the most common way is to simply plan a route via waypoints, and the aircraft will fly from waypoint to waypoint to waypoint, doing whatever that it's supposed to do. We need to get to the point where we can tell a vehicle to go from point A to point B, but also avoid everything in between there, and let it sort of make its own flight path and make its own decisions. So we're working on that right now. The project's called Resilient Autonomy, and we're trying to fuse all these different sensors together so that the aircraft can make its own decisions.
And we're going to talk a little bit more about resilient autonomy in a little bit. Another question was, how has the pandemic affected your work and any challenges or newfound opportunities to streamline the process?
It's affected our work greatly. As you can imagine, it's very tough to operate vehicles when you're not on center. I work from home quite a bit now, and we're just starting to go back in a little higher capacity. But yeah, it's made it a real challenge. But I have to say that a lot of folks have really risen to the occasion and made great strides. I thought when we first started this work from home thing that a lot of our projects were going to suffer because of that. But it really turns out that folks dig in and do what they can, and we've really done some great things. So I'm actually be in the office later today. We're prepping for a flight early next week, and it just makes us a little more focused is all, and you just have to plan a little bit further ahead.
Yeah, I think we're all feeling the effects of the pandemic there and adjusting and being flexible. I want to make sure we get in the other video. Time is flying in our episode here. So let's talk about one of the projects you're working on at Armstrong Flight Research Center, since the resilient autonomy was brought up once. We'll talk about that, and then we'll kind of move towards our next video, which is extremely exciting. I can't wait to see it.
Sure. So resilient autonomy basically encompasses all of the different technologies that we've developed along the way to put all together into a vehicle that will be able to choose its own flight path and make its own decisions. A piece of the software that we use is called a moral compass. And basically what that means is it weighs the different options for each outcome of the decision it chooses. And it chooses obviously the least, the least invasive or the least harmful option. So for instance, if you have an engine out scenario and you need to land somewhere, it knows the difference between a busy road and an open field and a grove of trees, right? Those are all sort of in its memory banks and it will choose between those to land safely as possible.
Okay, and the auto GCAS system that's incorporated in the resilient autonomy.
That's right. Auto GCAS is a portion of it, and Auto GCAS stands for Autonomous Ground Collision Avoidance Software. So every year, perfectly good pilots in perfectly good airplanes hit the ground for no good reason. They're disoriented. They become unconscious. They have a G loss induced consciousness. And, you know, we kill people. People aren't replaceable. You can replace airplanes. So this is a huge problem. So the engineers at Armstrong, in cooperation with the Air Force, developed Auto GCAS, which is basically a world terrain database. And this is before Google Earth, for instance, existed. And it's a piece of software that resides on the aircraft. And in our case, the UAS has a autopilot system. It's a fly-by-wire aircraft, so it's perfectly suited for this. And the aircraft knows where it's at in real time. It also knows the maximum performance of the aircraft and or the energy state, as we say, of the aircraft at any time. So it can perform a maneuver to take over when the pilot is not able to and avoid hitting the ground.
So if the pilot becomes unconscious,
any of that. Yep. So the system, runs. Yeah, the system is transparent. It runs behind everything else. So the pilot doesn't even know it's there unless the vehicle is on a trajectory that's going to impact terrain. It will take over quicker than the pilot can react and then recover the aircraft. And that's the video we're going to show. I have a video that shows some cockpit video of an F-16 that did exactly that.
Okay, let's watch the video and you can talk us through what's happening.
Great. So once we bring the video up and it'll start playing, we're going to pause it for a second and I'm going to explain a few things before we watch it. And we'll probably have to watch this a couple of times to sort of get everything that's going on. All right, so on the left side here, you see the number 476 in the box. That is airspeed. That's how fast the aircraft is going at this time. Right above that, you see the 2.5. That's the G-force on the aircraft. The portions that are blacked out, this is at Hill Air Force Base, and it's a flight of four F-16s. They're doing air combat maneuvering, so they're practicing dogfighting. So they're just blocking out some stuff that maybe is potentially sensitive there. Over on the right, that 17,290, that's the altimeter, and that's in MSL. That means above sea level, so not necessarily above ground level. Once this plays a little bit further, you're going to see a box right above the F box that'll say R, and that stands for radar altimeter. That's how high you are above the ground. So watch that box. Now pay attention to the G-force and the airspeed as we start maneuvering. So go ahead and, there's the airspeed, and right above that is the G-force. So pay particular attention to the G-force there and let it play, and we'll narrate that. So the pilot is maneuvering here. 1G is level flight, so it's just like you're sitting in your chair. Now you can see the G's building up. He's doing a very hard turn. 8.2 G's or 8.3 G's, the pilot is now unconscious, and the aircraft is heading essentially straight down. You can see the speed building. He's now supersonic, headed straight down. You pause it there. Now we have what we call a fly-up. That means the system is active. If you look at the radar altimeter, it's at 3,400 feet, which is less than a second from impacting the ground. If you watch the G-force build up, if you remember, the pilot passed out around 8.2 Gs. And I believe during the pull-up, that will actually reach 9.1 Gs. So the system actually is smart enough to know that it can exceed what the pilot can tolerate to save the aircraft. So you can keep playing again. Watch that G-force build up. So there's the recovery there. So the pilot is still unconscious. He's starting to come to. Flight leader's calling off the maneuver, telling everybody to stop what they're doing. And now the pilot is starting to come back to conscious right there. He levels the airplane. All right, you can pause it. All right, so let's rewind that back, watch it in real time. Pay particular attention to the G-force. And remember that he passes out at 8.3 G. And then when the fly-up happens, the recovery will happen, and you'll see 9.1 Gs as the aircraft, you know, nearly misses the ground going supersonic, all automatically. We can pause it there. So the flight lead was screaming at him, Sully two is his call sign, two recover. So he sees the aircraft going straight down, basically at 1G, so he's not flying the aircraft, nose low, and he was less than a second from impacting terrain. So this is an example of how AI can potentially save lives. We know of 12 fighters that have had their fighter pilots that have their lives saved so far by this system. I've seen similar video to this on 4 different occasions, and they're all just hair-raisingly scary. And it really sort of drives home, you know, what you're able to do with an unmanned aircraft.
Yeah, that was absolutely incredible. And if we can use that and incorporate it with the UAS, I mean, plus it's nice that to know that it's on these fighter jets, so that if anything does happen to our pilots, we've got a backup system to save the pilot, save the jet, save people or buildings below also.
So if I wasn't clear, that was developed on an unmanned aircraft, and it's deployed on F-16, F-22, and F-35. It comes right out of the factory with that installed.
That is absolutely amazing. We do have some more questions before I have to wrap things up, but I want to get these questions from our STEM fans. What advice do you give students who might be interested in UAS, but not necessarily know yet if they want to make that a career?
So there is not a great career path, a college path to get to UAS. There are a few colleges now with the option to study unmanned aircraft and unmanned aircraft systems. But in reality, you know, the model airplane thing is what got me there. These are essentially model airplanes, obviously quite a bit more sophisticated. But, you know, maybe look around at a local hobby shop or maybe a flying field and sort of see if that's something you like. And, you know, maybe check out a college that might have a career option in that field.
That's some great advice. And another question, have you done any work with heads-up display for pilots to orient themselves?
Sort of, yes. So the military aircraft have a set heads-up display. But as you saw in that last Sully video, the two little chevrons that come in from the side and the fly-up signage that comes up, we had to incorporate that. So we had to basically emulate an F-16 heads-up display, write our software, and make sure that it would incorporate with that in sort of a non-invasive way. But we don't deal like directly with the heads-up display, but that's sort of how we integrate the two together.
Well, we are running out of time. I need to wrap this up, but before we sign off, let me give our STEM fans a challenge. Their challenge or their mission is going to be the X-Plane Glider Design Challenge. The link will be put into the chat, and if they also would share their designs on social media at the hashtag NextGenSTEM, I would love to see what they have come up with. And also stay tuned next week for our next STEM star, Aaron Gronsdahl, who is the astrobiologist or geomicrobiologist. He's going to be here next week to talk about his journey to NASA. And then I will let Red end with giving his advice to students who may want to have a STEM career.
Sure, thank you. I get asked this question quite a bit, and there's no one easy answer. But the only thing I will say is that if you want to do it, if you have the passion, you'll find a way. So just keep your head down, ask questions, learn as much as you can, show the enthusiasm, and never give up.
Great advice. STEM fans, thanks for tuning in. Don't forget, subscribe below, and we will see you next week.